Good morning, students. Today we would be talking about relationship between international law and municipal law. This topic I have already taken up in class. Today I would just be revising this. So when we talk about relationship between international law and municipal law, this is very important. Why? Because international law develops when we give part of our sovereignty. So when we talk about municipal law is a reflection of state sovereignty and it governs the relationship between individual. I repeat again that municipal law is a reflection of state sovereignty and governs the relationship between individual among themselves and individual and the state organ. But when we talk about international law, I told you that international law has developed because we have given part of our sovereignty. Okay, due to which international law has developed. Now when we come to international law, it says that international law is that which governs the relationship between state among themselves or between state and other entities upon whom international legal personality has been conferred. So it is generally concerned with international community and its legal order. Now as a consequence, there is a relationship between the two legal system, that is municipal legal system and international legal system, and the relationship between the two can be studied from two approaches. The first approach would be the jurisprudential approach, which would be talking about two distinct system of law. One is a dualistic approach we'll be talking about, another one we'll be talking about is the monistic approach. The second we would be talking about is the practical situation. Practical situation, here we would be talking about, you know, when conflict exists or when conflict occurs between which rule would be applied, that is rule of international law or rule of municipal law. So first we would be studying about jurisprudential approach of relationship between international law and municipal law. And here as I told you we would be talking about two kinds of approaches. One is dualistic approach, another one is monistic approach. Now, if we talk about dualistic approach, under this doctrine, international law and municipal law are two independent and separate legal system. So, dualistic doctrine is based on the view that international law is a law applicable between the sovereign state and municipal law is that law which is applied within a state and regulates the activity of its citizen. So, the chief exponent of this doctrine are Triple and Angelotti. And according to monistic theory, international law and municipal law are both part of the same universal legal order, and international law is supreme even within the municipal sphere. So according to them, it does not matter whether it is individual or state that is bound, because in the final analysis, the state is but a group of individuals looked as an entity. So main exponent of this are Hans Kelsen and Sir Lauterpacht. Now if we talk about the two kind of approaches, in dualism we saw that there are two branches of law. One branch totally dedicated to municipal law and one branch totally dedicated to international law. But monism, as the name suggests, we have just one legal system, and international law and municipal law are part of that legal system. So there is no different branches, there is only one branch. Then when we come to supremacy of international law, or if we talk about whether the supremacy of international law rests in law as a whole or in particular principle only, we have to understand, students, that whenever there is an international law, it has to be applied to the municipal level. Now when we are applying this international law to the municipal level, we have to understand that why should we apply that international law? Because every country, if you talk about India, India is sovereign. Then why should we adhere to whatever UN Charter, whatever is written in the UN Charter, or for that matter, why should we adhere to what is written in UDHR or ICCPR? So, but we are. Why? Because we have ratified, we have signed the treaty. But then also, why are we doing that? Because we have given part of the sovereignty, we have ratified that, and we live in this, organized world. So, where we follow certain norms, certain rule, and certain code of conduct. Now, how do we apply something that is there at the international sphere? Student, I have told this to you again, that whenever there is an international law, for example, if we talk about environmental law, we have witnessed Stockholm Declaration, we have witnessed Rio de Janeiro Declaration, which is also known as Earth Summit, we have witnessed a lot of other summits. whatever was said in those conferences was adopted at municipal level in India by passing the Environmental Protection Act 1986. This Environmental Protection Act incorporated all the suggestion that was given at Stockholm or Rio Declaration. So this is how you specifically adopt something that has been given at the international sphere. That is specific adoption theory. Now when we talk about transformation theory says that the law was already there. What we have done is we have transformed our law to incorporate those new principle, new ideology that was there at the international level. So in specific adoption, there was no law at municipal level and we have adopted it. Transformation, the law was already there and we have transformed our law so that to cater to the needs of the international system. Now, when we talk about, these two different kinds of theory, in between, a new theory came up that was known as theory of coordination. This theory of coordination was given by Sir Gerland, and he argued that two system does not come into conflict with legal system. He meant to say that international and municipal law are not conflicting each other. They operate at different sphere, each being superior in its own field. For example, if we talk about international law and municipal law, they are a different system and they are, applied in different sphere or at different legal fields. So this is theory of coordination that Professor Sir Gerland has talked about. So this is specific adoption theory where you are, specifically adopting it in your municipal law. We talk about transformation theory where you have transformed the existing municipal law. And then we talk about theory of coordination that there is no, conflict between the two legal systems, that is municipal law and international law. They are applied in two different fields. Now, the practical approach is that yes, there exists, conflict between international law and municipal law does exist, and there is a international tribunal, jurist and state show preference for practice over theory. Now what is the practice in general we're talking about? Now when we talk about when a conflict arises between international and municipal law, what is the position? Now principle of supremacy of international law does not have a good ground in municipal law system, because municipal law, we feel that our municipal law is supreme. International law is not concerned with the instrument that state used to implement the international engagement. It concerns is that the state effect their engagement in the matter most suited to them. So if at municipal level I feel that this particular law is useful to us, I will adopt. If I feel that this is not useful to us, we will not adopt. So municipal law is supreme when we talk about in practice. For instance, if we talk about constitution of many states, provide that adoption of rule of international law by incorporating them into your municipal system or transforming your municipal legal system that we've talked about earlier on. Now we'll be talking about the Indian perspective. How are we taking international law? So if we talk about Indian perspective, we need to first quote Article 51 of the Constitution of India, which talks that it talks about promotion of international peace and security, and state shall endeavor. Here we are obligating the state by using the word shall. Now this word shall is making it obligatory for the state to do the following things. To do what? Number one, to promote international peace and security. Number two, maintain just and honorable relations between the nation. Number three, foster respect for international law and treaty obligation in dealing of organized people with one another. And number four, encourage settlement of international dispute by arbitration. Now, if we study Article 51, student, you should always remember that it is always studied with Article 37 of the Constitution of India, which says that the provision contained in this part, that is Part 4, shall not be enforceable by any court, but the principles laid therein are nevertheless fundamental in the governance of the country, and it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making law. So you see that Article 51 is talking about so many important things. It is talking about promoting international peace and security. Secondly, it is talking about maintaining just and honorable relation between nations. And third, which is most important, is foster respect for international law and treaty obligation. This is what incorporates the principle of pacta sur servanda, that is, you are a servant to treaty. Now, when we talk about Article 253, Article 253 of the Constitution confers power upon the Parliament to enact law relating to treaties, to give effect to such treaty, protocols, covenant, agreement, and convention entered into by India with one or more countries, an intergovernmental organization, or any decision concluded at international conference in which India was participant. Now, this provision totally talks about what I have been explaining you so far, that whatever has been decided at international conferences or international covenant agreement, they have to be incorporated in and enacted in our Indian laws. So if you see, India has accepted customary international law in her internal law. It is similar to that of British practice. So both India and British, we follow dualistic approach. That is, there are two branches of law. One is international and other one is municipal law. So this is the practice which is prevalent both in India and Britain. Thank you, student. This was all that I had to tell you with respect to relationship between international law and municipal law. Thank you. If you have any queries, please feel free to contact me either through mail or WhatsApp group. Thank you.